going back to the moon and back to Mars. Astronauts already selected. And whenever we do, we are gonna need to eat. A trip to Mars, they're gonna be there 3 to 5 years. They have to bring all the food for the whole trip with them. Which means if we're shipping them food, that's thousands of kilograms. We could save so much money and time and worry about decay and sickness if we have them grow food themselves to farm, like in Star Trek Voyager, hydroponics or something. So excited. Today, how are we gonna eat on other planets? What are we gonna eat? Because surely not cows. Are astronauts gonna be vegetarian? Because that might be a thing that we have to do because we can't take chickens to Mars. This is gonna be so cool. So let's kick into it and find out what's up. Hi. Welcome to episode 5 of 5 on Eatin' Good in the Galactic Neighborhood. We have talked all about food and how much it costs to eat vegetarian versus meats. We've talked about, oh my God, so many different things over the last 5 episodes. Go back and watch them if you haven't already. Space food actually reflects the era of space travel that you're in. So here's how it started. Here's how it's going. I had to meme a little bit. So the first human to eat in space was Yuri Gagarin. He was eating 2 servings of pureed meat and then 1 of chocolate sauce for dessert, all out of a tube. Yuck. The first American was John Glenn. He had applesauce out of a tube. Tubal sauce. Yuck. All throughout the Mercury program and early Russian programs, tube food was the thing. It was literally pureed and put in a tube. During the Gemini program, or Gemini, as my friend Amy Scheretitel would say, we were eating freeze-dried food made with cryodesiccation. Today, the Space Food Division in Houston has over 200 different meals that the NASA astronauts can pick. And of course, there are different meals for different astronauts from different countries. The first Mexican astronaut flew and asked about tortillas, and now that's the only bread product they had. They couldn't eat bread before. It was too crummy and would fly over and get in the instruments. Yay, diversity. It made astronauts' life better. Freeze drying is essentially the best of flash frozen and dehydrated. Frozen maintains flavor and preservatives. Dehydration preserves for longer. It takes about a week to make freeze dried food. And if well done, the food can last 20 years. We can use the water on board the spacecraft to rehydrate it, and that allows us to eat all sorts of food in space. Fruit and vegetables are popular. Juices and soups are eaten in space. Meatballs, peanut butter, and jam. Shrimp cocktail is a favorite amongst modern astronauts. Humans have to eat. It's not just to sustain our bodies. You know, we can't just give all astronauts milkshakes that contain all our nutrients. The psychology of eating is really important. And the kicker here is that every single food item for the last 70 years, every food eaten in space, more or less, except a couple exceptions, came from Earth. It was shipped to space. So knowing that you can't live in low Earth orbit forever, you need to learn a few things, like how to grow plants in space. The Advanced Plant Experiment, or APEX, has been going for a long time now. It's about a suitcase-sized box with reddish-pink lights in it to make sure that we can grow food in space, because there's no rule that says it should. The first harvest of lettuce grown in space was in 2014. This is that one little exception I was talking about. They harvested and ate it, literally right there out of the machine. Sure, there was a lot of approvals required for them to be able to do that. Obviously, you can't just wash vegetables under the sink in space, so instead they had to wipe the leaves with sanitizing wipes. Space, not exactly the most exciting or luxurious place. Next up, they want to grow dragoon lettuce, wasabi mustard, Russian kale, tomatoes and peppers are on the list too. And a private company I spoke to said they're working on radishes in space, which is divisive. I like radishes, but a lot of people don't. Make some people fart. Maybe not the best in space. Probably, though, you remember the Martian potatoes growing in space on Mars. We'll get there. The thing is that growing a flat food like lettuce is much easier in space. Think of it as a one-dimensional food. It doesn't have to grow a lot of thickness. Solid, bulbous foods, they are different. No gravity could affect them in a more complex way than it does a thin food like lettuce. Of course, we'll know soon enough. Even if they grow peppers, kale, radish, and tomatoes in space, there's no way to fry them up yet. On top of that, we need to learn how to grow other stuff like berries and beans. And it's an issue for deep space missions. We don't want astronauts getting scurvy when they're away on Mars for months and they can't just take supplements for it. It's amazing that we could be talking about agriculture on another planet at all. But the fact that we're talking about this futuristic idea of living on Mars with this ancient idea of growing food while we live there. And this is in part because, like we talked about in episode 2 of this show, we don't have replicators. We don't have a way to have a globalized industrial food system to feed astronauts. They'd have to do it themselves. If we're gonna get them food on another planet, we're gonna need new ideas. So luckily, there was a paper titled Feeding 1 Million People on Mars. And they thought this through, and they determined that there is a mix of 3 things that you need: vegetables, insect products, Bioreactor Products. Yum. Vegetables. This is the ISS system that I mentioned, Apex and Veggie. You would scale that up, like the Martian. Again, you would have astronauts becoming farmers, which may seem boring, but for them, might be psychologically beneficial. Seeing something birth, grow, develop, harvest, birth, grow, you know, that we evolved with that cycle and it could be beneficial to all of us. A simple static ship in space works in the movies, but in reality, it's psychologically a little bit of a downer. If we grow them in underground greenhouses for warmth and radiation protection, then the Martian soil, we think, could grow food, at least based on what we know. NASA and the International Potato Center, awesome, which is a team in Peru, potatoes are native to South America, FYI. They took desert soil, which is inhospitable to life, and they put a potato plant inside of a sealed container in extreme conditions using special lights, and they grew a potato. So even though the Martian is not fact, Mars taters might be a thing, and this is a good step. The problem is it probably had microbes even in that soil that was inhospitable from a desert. And microbes work with the plants in the nitrogen cycle, maybe you remember from elementary school. So no microbes equals no nitrogen equals no plants. Human poop is not the magic ingredient. On top of that, soil, which exists here on Earth, does not exist on other planets. They call their topsoil regolith. And Mars dirt, or regolith, doesn't have that light, airy texture of Earth's soil. Soil is like a sponge. It swells with water, absorbs, and holds stuff. Regolith simulant, in one experiment, mixed with water and got hard like concrete. Not the best for growing a plant. In fact, all the plants they tried to grow in it died. On top of that, Mars dirt has calcium perchlorate in it, a toxic substance that is deadly to plants, so that's a big deal. Like I said, there's no rule that anything will grow in space. There's a lot of hurdles to jump. They evolved here, we have to figure out how to get them to live there. Either way, once we figure out plants, the next on the list, insects. Could also grow these in tunnels, I'm guessing. The insects don't require a lot of land or water to produce lots of biomass. Crickets are high in protein and can be converted into protein powder that can be added to lots of different foods to make sure you have nutrients. And you could perhaps even bring insects that consume waste and products from farms and dwellings, which would help a lot because it's not like you're gonna be able to throw stuff away easily on Mars. And then of course, finally, bioreactor products, which sounds gross, but we talked about it earlier in episode 3. Lab-grown meat, plant-based meat. You can't bring chickens and goats to space. They graze a lot. They would need a huge amount of plant food in order to sustain themselves, just so you could then eat them. Instead, lab-grown meat. Make it in a bioreactor, no waste products, just energy to produce food. You also don't run into that 1,000-pound cow makes 440 pounds of meat problem. Those three things together could mean a sustainable population on Mars, and they looked at it up to 1 million people. Something not thought about in this paper is plant-based meats, plant-based milks, bioreactor-grown fish proteins. There might be a lot of vegetarians on Mars, or even vegans, because there likely won't be any animals on Mars, and thus no animal products. Probably all the plants on Mars would be hybrids, modified to grow well in harsh environments. Maybe they'll take genes from desert plants and mix them with high-yield plants, just like Borlaug's wheat that I mentioned earlier, but for space, it's just gonna be humans, plants, technology, and bacteria all trying to survive together in one of the harshest environments we can imagine. If we ever go to deep space, out of Earth shipping distance, then it'll really be exciting because that's all hypothetical. We have no idea what we would eat then, unless we can invent replicators. Literal ones, not the $1 hamburger magic of the 21st century. Just think though, at one point in time, that $1 hamburger was the future. That was some imagining of a small business owner. I'm a small business. In fact, over the last 2 years, I've learned so much from classes on Skillshare to run my small business. Classes like Holly's. She helps people who want to start a small business find their strengths and create a plan to get there.
Having that foundation of skills gives me the freedom to move where I want to move with my passion and my purpose as my guiding compass.
If you want to try Skillshare and learn all sorts of cool stuff, you can be one of the first 1,000 people to use this link to get a free trial of Skillshare Premium. It's totally worth it and it's free. If it's faux free, it's faux me. There's no manual to run a small business, and I get things wrong all the time, but that's part of learning. And classes can help minimize those mistakes. Skillshare offers thousands of different courses for creative and curious people just like you, and they have classes on topics across illustration and design, photography, video, freelancing, creative writing, music production, web development, graphic design, so many things. You can learn a bit about almost anything on Skillshare, and that is my favorite part. Skillshare is for creative and curious people who are lifelong learners. And honestly, I think that sounds like you. So try it, let me know what you think, and thanks. Let's get back to the series. Honestly though, even if there was a way to get meat to space, we'd probably go through the same issues we had in the 20th century. We would want meat, and then we would use economics to get it. Then we'll have meat plus classism plus economics, and evolution will not have changed us by then, so we'll just end up with the same problems that we have here on Earth. If we want to go to Mars or anywhere else, we don't need to learn how to make meat there. We need to learn how to bring new lifestyles there, new ideas. Insects for protein, algae for nutrients. And if we want to live there long term, we humans, we need to be better. And honestly, that would apply here at home too. We need to do better if we want to live here just as much as if we want to live there. Space is just an analog for living better on Earth. So why can't we do that now? After 5 episodes of this series, we know so much more about food and we've thought about it so much deeper. Vegetables are cheaper to buy and eat. You can be better for the environment by buying more vegetables and eating less meat. If you want a life on another planet, you're gonna have to learn to love vegetables. Globalization has made possible all sorts of futuristic achievements like $1 cheeseburgers. And replicators don't exist yet, but the idea of a food item that's on demand and encompasses vegetables, fruits, breads, meats, sugars, fats, all for a dollar is crazy and damaging. We learned that we are borrowing from the future to feed the now, and that is never gonna last. But we have so much space and so much time to make structural changes in our lives and our cultures, to be able to work together and have as many people on this planet fed, and on the next planet, and the one after that. The future of food is weird, right? Insects, plant-based meats, bioreactor products. But of course, white bread, bananas, ruby red grapefruit, and peanut butter were all weird at one point. These days, they're commonplace. I hope you loved this series. I really loved learning all about it. I am Trace. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the future.